And good morning, everyone. Welcome to This Day.
Welcome and good morning. Hi, I'm back. And today is Thursday, January. Gosh.
See, yeah, it's January. It's January 20th. We fooled
it's
you.
July 20th. It's National Hire a Veteran Day, and I'll tell you
that's
all about
a good
that.
One.
It is a good one.
You know what's strange? I was just thinking about it. One week, I'm all the way in Alaska, and you were all the way in Hawaii. We couldn't have been just opposite ends of our 49th and 50th states.
That's right. So we thought we'd give the U.S. a try this
yes.
time instead of someplace else. But nonetheless, we're going to tell you who is on our show.
All right. Well, Leslie Gabola is going to be here from Adapt to It, and she's bringing along a guest, Gina Reich, and they're going to be having a kind of a gala party celebrating their, I think, 17th anniversary coming up. Tell you all about that. Also from the Orange County Sheriff's Department, we have Captain Jeff Puckett will be here. He's going to talk about many different things that, of course, the Sheriff's Department does, how they work with the homeless. We've got great photos with some kids and all kinds of different things. Also, the Santa Ana Zoo is having an event coming up, a gala event, fundraising one, and we've got a couple guests that are coming on to tell you all about that. And with Erica Ritchie, we are going to give you the Globe headlines.
Excellent. All right, so we have one meeting today, and it is the GRF Agenda Prep Meeting, and that will be in the Willow Room. You have the boardroom, maybe it's boardroom.
Let's see.
Oh,
Willow Room.
So, okay, so every day, hundreds of our military personnel leave the service in search of civilian employment. National Hire a Veteran Day reminds employers to consider veterans to fill their open positions. As highly trained, qualified individuals, they're ideal for numerous trades. Legislation protects separating servicemen and women as they enter the civilian workforce. However, the best way a potential employer can honor a veteran is to hire one. Skills gained in the military world transfer to the civilian world regardless of the position, find qualified candidates in a range of fields. Marine Corps veteran Dan Caporale, founder of Hire Our Heroes, also founded National Hire a Veteran Day to provide a call to action to hire more veterans by spreading awareness and creating the number one veteran job board platform, HireOurHeroes.com, which has become the connective tissue that connects corporate America with our veterans and veteran spouses looking for employment. So if you are a veteran and you would like to work, then that would be an awesome resource for you. So, Ken, it looks as though I brought the tropical weather with me from Hawaii. What's going on?
I know. It does seem that way. You know, I call it like Florida-like weather. And there was actually quite a bit of rain this morning. I mean, not in the scope of things, not a lot. But considering, you know, that we're going to have some throughout the morning today. And then partly cloudy this afternoon. So very Florida-like. There are not for here. But just to let you know, there are flash flood warnings. And that's going to be in like the Riverside area, the deserts, and of course the mountain areas. I just want to let you know, they were getting a lot of thunder strikes out in the deserts, 29 Palms area, Palm Springs area today, this morning. So keep that in mind. As we move forward though, things will be a little less humid tomorrow. And then as we move forward, we are going to see that we're going to be in a pattern for about 3 days, sunny and mostly sunny and warm. However, coming up next week, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, although I don't think the temps will be as high, the humidity will be back. This is perfectly normal for this time of the year as we see the latter part of July and then into August. In fact, there have been times we get hailstorms. In fact, there was a hailstorm out there this morning in 29 Palms, so not unusual at all. I know one year I was planting corn, it was this high, it got destroyed by the hail. What can you do? All right, let's look around the county and beyond today. And still warm out there. Beach is about 83. Hawaii, okay, we changed that. I had Florida-like. You snuck in and changed it Hawaii-like. But either way, it is that way for sure. So if you like this kind of weather, I really don't mind. It was kind of refreshing having the rain this morning. The dogs were totally confused, which, you know, is kind of comical. But here we are. Warm weather, humid. And tomorrow, I think we're going to be less so. But you know, this changes here and there when we get this type of tropical system in. All right, we'll be back in just a moment.
What lies inside all of us is more than data. It's life. What's flowing through America's veins is its diversity. We ask for 1 million individuals to come forward and stand on this landmark in history. All of us are different, and it's those very differences that will lead to answers for generations to come.
At Freedom Village Assisted Living, we provide loving care and support when your loved one needs it most. We believe in laughing more and caring more. Dining will be an experience, not just a meal. We offer opportunities to create new memories. Your family will feel like they are part of our family as we work toward creating an extraordinary difference in lives worth living. To schedule a tour and complimentary lunch, and for more information, please call us at 949-340-8108 or visit our website, freedomvillage.org.
Welcome to South County Adult Day Services. Conveniently located right here in Laguna Woods, we provide a safe, secure environment where you or your loved one can spend the day. Come socialize with friends, engage in enriching activities, receive the expert care you need, and participate in fun hobbies. Improve your mental and physical health and maintain your independence. We even take care of transportation. For a free tour, call us at 949-855-9444 or visit us at our center between El Toro and Moulton Parkway right next to the Olive Garden.
Welcome back. I have Captain Jeff Puckett, who is here from the Orange County Sheriff's Department, and he's going to tell us all about what you do, your new position, and also what's going on in our community here.
Well, thank you for having me on this morning. Mm-hmm. Appreciate it. So, as you said, I'm the new captain to the area, and mm-hmm. I think the viewers should know that prior to working down here, I ran our North Patrol division, which encompasses a number of contract cities in North County. So. Mm-hmm. New to the position, but not new to the job, so to
right.
speak. So we would like to take the time today to introduce our Southwest Division, which obviously encompasses the city of Laguna Woods, and just kind of talk about the direction that we're going to be going over the next 18 months and how that affects the people that live here.
Okay.
So for the Southwest Division, we encompass 7 different contract cities, which include obviously the beautiful city of Laguna Woods, mm-hmm. San Clemente, Dana Point, San Juan Capistrano, gets a little long-winded, so stay with me.
That's no problem.
Laguna Hills, Laguna Niguel, and Aliso Viejo.
Okay.
And so with that, we serve a population total of about 300,000 people mm-hmm. and encompass an area of about 72 square miles. And what's interesting about that is usually the Sheriff's Department being kind of the lowest priced game in town. And whenever we say that, people usually scratch their heads because lower prices usually means not as good of quality. But typically the areas that we serve are within the safest cities in the nation. As a matter of fact, this division is constantly ranked as one of the top 100 safest areas in the nation.
Okay.
So interesting fact. There's 270 people assigned to the division. And I like to stress that point because the Sheriff's Department, having over 4,000 people assigned to the department, are at the disposal of Laguna Woods. And even though there are only six contracted deputies here in times of emergency, the full power of the Sheriff's Department is available to help keep the citizens here safe.
Okay, well, that's good to know that they have that many people that they could refer to if needed.
An army, almost.
An army, pretty much.
Yeah.
I know, it's like having a troop.
Yes,
all right,
ma'am.
Excellent. All right, so, you know, what are exactly the, you know, I know you patrol the area, but there's a lot of other things that go on. So what are some of the other responsibilities that you have for these areas?
Well, we are responsible for everything that could possibly happen public safety-wise for the areas that we serve. And we want to highlight maybe the direction that we're going to go for this division. And obviously public safety is always going to be at the top of the list. But some of the things that we're going to put an emphasis on, if you will, would be first and foremost some of our community policing efforts. As a matter of fact, your chief of police services, who will be on subsequently in later episodes, is at a Coffee with a Cop of event down off Moulton Parkway at the Coffee Bean.
Okay.
And if your viewers are available, the address for that is 24380 Moulton Parkway, and that event will be going on until 10 o'clock this morning.
Okay.
It's a good opportunity for them to meet their chief and the deputies assigned to the community and have a conversation about the things that are going on and what are some of the things that we can do to increase public safety in this area.
Okay. So now what day is that?
Right now.
Oh, that's right now.
Yeah,
oh, gosh.
Started at 8 o'clock this morning.
Okay. Is that something that's going to be ongoing, though? So it's not necessarily just today.
So you'll see more events like that. You'll see another event, which if we can not make some jokes, I'd appreciate it, but donuts with deputies. You'll see some of that for some of our other morning viewers.
Mm-hmm.
And you're going to see your chief on this episode and future episodes going forward from now on to talk about different things that happen in the community. As a matter of fact, on August 22nd, he'll be doing a seminar at Laguna Hills City Hall to talk about fraud prevention and some of the scams that affect this population.
Well, that's great, because there are a lot of scams that are going on. And it's not just to the elderly, it's to old people, but nonetheless, it seems that sometimes the elderly are falling for these things much, much easier these days, because people are getting so smart on the phone.
Well, they're sophisticated, but so are we, and so our goal here is to educate the public, which goes into our next focus, which is going to be crime prevention.
Okay.
Now, you're going to see in coming episodes, your chief will talk about things like Stay Safe OC, which is an overall program sponsored by Sheriff Barnes to talk about different ways that the community can be, as he says, co-collaborators of their own safety. How can we involve the community to make sure that we're all being as safe as possible?
Right.
So that would include things also like Neighborhood Watch, and different venues that the public's already aware of.
Now, Tim Moy, as you know, he's our chief of security here, and he comes on pretty regularly to tell us a lot about what's going on, primarily some of the things that you're talking about.
Sure.
And they have captains for each little community, and they do a really good job here of really educating. So how do you guys work with our chief of security?
Well, to put it bluntly, we work very well with your chief of security, and I would say this community should feel very lucky and blessed that he is at the helm. I don't think it's any secret that he's a former commander with our organization and really just an icon with the Sheriff's Department. You could probably tell that he's also a close friend of mine. And the reason that I think that's important that everyone knows is because it's those relationships when there's a time of crisis or need that become critically important towards increasing public safety.
Mm-hmm.
They always say that when the event happens, that isn't the first time that you want to meet the other individual in charge.
Mm-hmm.
That relationship, if it's already established, makes for a much more smooth incident and helps to keep the people safe overall.
Excellent, excellent. All right, so emergency preparation.
Yes, that's our next thing.
Mm-hmm.
And so with that, I know it's been talked about before, but you'll hear us continue to stress it, but there's a program called Alert OC, which is a notification process that we can get into more in other episodes coming up. And I think Michelle Anderson may have spoke to it 2 days ago on a different episode as well. But earthquakes that just happen, it is fire season, and we've had fires down here before. We want to make sure that everybody knows what the plan is and what we can do to assist with evacuations and just overall that mitigation ahead of time.
Mm-hmm. Great, so, great. Yeah. And then homelessness, we have seen it right here in our own backyard. And I know you're a liaison for a lot of that, or are you not a liaison for us, or tell me your responsibility
with
that?
Well, it's interesting because when everyone starts their career, they obviously want to do the things, I think, that are more exciting with police work. They want to arrest the bad guys and do things of that nature. And so for me, I don't know if I've ever set out to be the quote-unquote homeless expert for the department, but that's certainly the mantra that's been bestowed upon me. Mm-hmm. So I say that with a little tongue-in-cheek, but the sheriff has an expectation that homelessness in this area is addressed, mm-hmm. and we do that with a philosophy of what we call outreach and enforcement.
Okay.
So our philosophy is that the Sheriff's Department has an obligation to protect the constitutional rights of everybody in the jurisdiction that we serve. Mm-hmm. And just because somebody's homeless doesn't mean, in fact, that that alone is a criminal activity. So we want to make sure that our deputies are trained that when we come across somebody that doesn't have a place to sleep, that we can provide outreach to try and get them into a better situation in life.
Right.
But we would also stress that just because you're homeless doesn't give you a free pass to break the law.
Right.
So the only thing that gets a touch tricky is when it comes to illegal camping, and the courts, the federal courts, have been very clear that shelter is what's needed to enforce that law, and right now that's just not an option that we have. Mm-hmm. Laguna Woods, however, is a different story because behind the gates it's private property.
Right.
And so we have an excellent relationship again with Tim Moy and his staff towards using some different strategies to mitigate any issues behind the gates.
Right, and so far it seems like you guys are well ahead of what's going on in some other cities. We're finding that it's kind of taking over. So learning from that, you certainly can get ahead of the situation. So.
Yeah, and it's an issue that we continue to address and develop and look at on a daily basis.
Excellent, excellent. So you talked about the community outreach. What about, I don't know, overall, like what kind of things are going on today other than fraud that you would alert our citizens to be aware of?
Well, I would tell you the things that we would talk about are things that I feel the citizens here are already doing. You know, my mother is a citizen of Laguna Woods and lives not too far from here, as a matter of fact. And I think Laguna Woods has always had an excellent informal neighborhood watch program, if you will. Everybody here is very in tune into what's going on with the community, and that's very unlike any other cities that we serve. And I would tell you that is probably one of the main reasons that Laguna Woods is as safe as it is. The deputies and the security staff can only be so many places, but as the citizens who live there, if they're keeping a watchful eye on things and reporting to us, it's that co-collaboration that really keeps things as safe as they are. So what I would encourage is, If you see something, say something.
Right.
And continue to call us. And right. It's worked out well so far.
Perfect. Well, is there any last things that you'd like to let us know about?
No.
You've covered everything quite well.
We just appreciate the opportunity to be part of this community and continue to serve it. And I would ask that your city chief, Gene Inouye, who will be on a future episode, stay in contact with him and continue to address the community needs through him, and we'll be here to serve.
Excellent. Well, we look forward to the information. Thank you so much for being here today.
A pleasure. Thank you.
And remember that you can go to Coffee Bean right here on Moulton this morning up till 10 o'clock so you can chat with our local sheriff today. We'll be right back.
We now know with certainty that starting screening mammograms at age 40 and repeating them yearly has the potential to save thousands of lives every year.
In patients with no risk factors, they should start annual mammography at age 40.
The Society of Breast Imaging, the American College of Radiology, the American College of OBGYN.
Okay.
Their guidelines are that an average risk woman begin screening mammogram at age 40.
Right now it's a very confusing time, not only for patients but for providers, because multiple different organizations are making different recommendations. right now it seems as though the most general gist is women should start screening in their 50s if they're at average risk. But a lot of women are not average risk. They've delayed childbearing, you know, till they're later in life. So that places them at increased risk. Or they've had biopsies that, you know, show atypia, they have family history. So if they're not at risk, they really should start screening earlier on, like at age 40.
Women should begin their annual mammograms starting at the age of 40.
Well, early detection is key, and we recommend at breast length to get mammograms starting at age 40 for patients without significant risk factors for breast cancer, which is in line with the American College of Radiology, Society of Breast Imaging, the Mayo Clinic, and the American Council for Obstetrics and Gynecology.
There's so many controversies, and women are so confused. Even the doctors are confused. The biggest one that comes out right now is this 40, not 50 argument. The government committee is telling women to start mammograms at age 50. We know starting at age 40 saves thousands of lives, and yet.
When your sticker package arrives, follow the simple instructions on the envelope. It's important to know that the sticker must be adhered to the inside of your vehicle before driving on a tolled bridge, lane, or road. There! You're all set to go out and enjoy the drive. A new drive awaits on the toll roads of Orange County.
I've been working with retirees since 1984. I specialize in protecting people's money, setting up a secure retirement income stream for them, and making sure their money is there when they need it. I started Sterling Financial Advisors under the premise that we not only needed quality service for clients out there in the financial industry, but ethical standards as well. We don't have any monopoly on the investments we use. What we do have a monopoly on is the integrity and how we treat our clients.
Parkinson's disease is a neurological movement disorder affecting an estimated 1 million Americans, including many under age 40. It has no cure. Parkinson's is not limited to how a person moves. It can also cause symptoms like depression, fatigue, and impaired speech. Today, there is a new diagnosis every 9 minutes, though Parkinson's can be present for years before being diagnosed. The American Parkinson Disease Association is the largest grassroots network in the United States, working to help ease the burden and find the cure. For more than 50 years, APDA has funded pioneering research and provided critical support to those affected by Parkinson's. Visit APDAoptimism.org today to find out how you can help millions live with dignity and optimism. Your action today will help APDA put an end to Parkinson's disease.
I'm Wendy Miller, your smiley realtor with RE/MAX and your Laguna Woods real estate specialist. I'm here today with the first of my 7 home selling tips for seniors. Some seniors prefer to rely on the real estate agent who has sold the most properties in their neighborhood. Others seek the most often recommended from family and friends. The right professional will ask questions about your future goals. He or she will help you decide upon a realistic listing price and answer all of your questions promptly before asking you to sign a listing agreement. Give me a call and I will help you make the right move.
Welcome back. Well, one of my favorite subjects, which is the Santa Ana Zoo, is here today with us. We have Diane and Larry Grummet, who are here to tell us all about the fun that you can have at the zoo. I mean, a lot of people don't even know about the zoo, right? Sure. In the middle of the city.
Yeah.
And then you guys have a really special event that's coming up in August. So welcome, both of you.
Thank you.
Nice to meet you. So you guys go kind of way back with the zoo. Tell me how you two like kind of got together at the zoo.
Well, we actually were dating when I hired into the zoo. I've been there about 14 years.
Okay.
And we were dating at the time. And she'd come down when I was working and kind of volunteer and worked in the farm a little bit.
Uh-huh.
And then we ended up getting married there.
You got married at the zoo?
We got
oh,
married,
my gosh.
We got married at the zoo.
What section?
The Amazon's edge, right, by, right on the platform by the waterfall over there.
Mm-hmm. That's perfect. Yeah. Do they? Because we shot there last year, uh-huh. and they were redoing a lot of that. Have they done that yet?
Yeah, they started doing, because that's going to be our new exhibit, which is the giant river otters from the Amazon of South America.
Right.
And it's going to be underwater viewing, and it's going to be really great when it gets.
Right. See, we're showing a little bit of it now. So is that so that is not complete yet?
No. They're starting. It's probably a good maybe year off. It's going to be quite a project.
Yeah, I
but
bet.
But it's going to be really great when they finish it up.
So, Diane, what do you do at the zoo?
I work in the gift shop and I do inventory.
Okay, but you work at the gift shop. That's an important job because there's a lot of fun things, as you can see here on our desk.
It all came from our gift shop.
That's right. And then, you know, the 50 monkeys. All year long. Give me just a brief history of that.
Okay. First of all, the zoo opened in 1952, mm-hmm. 67 years ago. Mm-hmm. But and it would the land was donated for the zoo in 1949. Mm-hmm. And Mr. Prentice, who donated the land, stipulated that we have to have at least 50 monkeys at all times.
Right.
So back in those days, when it was a lot, mainly country around there, he'd had monkeys, and he was a big fan of monkeys, so he stipulated 50 monkeys at all times. So that's what we have to this day.
And you guys do a really good job of having a variety of different monkeys.
Oh, yeah. And matter of fact, we have a pygmy marmoset, which is the world's smallest monkey, weighs 6 ounces full growth.
Oh, my gosh. That is so adorable. And to see them when you go down that one little alleyway with all the monkeys is so fun because they're always so
monkey
active.
Roll, yeah.
Yeah, the monkey roll. Yeah. What are some new things that are there?
About just over a year ago, we opened up our 50 monkey Ferris wheel.
Oh, right. Yeah. That's
And of course, our next project is the giant river otters.
Right. Right. Good.
So we're in a growing process right now, so there's going to be a lot of changes
coming
down.
But that's good. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's becoming more and more popular. I think people are coming more. They're hearing more about it, so mm-hmm. You're going to have to start getting some more animals in there, you know?
Yeah.
to keep everybody entertained.
Yeah, well, we got a big 20-year plan going on now, and there's going to be a lot of changes. So
nice.
All for the better.
All right, excellent. So let's talk about some of these cute little adorable stuffed animals here. Now, these are available in the gift shop, right?
Yes.
And money goes towards what when you buy things there?
It goes right back into the zoo.
It does. Mm-hmm. Okay. So for different types of events or projects that you're working on?
The projects, different things for animals.
Right. Okay, good. Now, you have a couple little lemurs here. Now, I was telling you before the show that I fed some of those lemurs. Now, how many lemurs do you guys have?
We have the ring-tailed lemurs, and we have the black and white ruffed lemurs.
Right. Now, those are in a separate location, right?
Mm-hmm.
Because they're really not considered a monkey.
No, not really.
Okay. So not. And then what about the one in the middle?
That's a river otter.
Okay.
And we got those in because we're getting the giant river otters.
Right. Oh, when does that happen?
They're going to be unique creatures. They're not the little river otters that most people think of as otters. They're about 6 feet.
Oh, wow. Yeah. That's big.
And their only known enemy in the wild is a panther. So they're very unique.
Now, where will they go?
They're going to go over by the Amazon's edge.
Oh, okay. So they'll be there. Mm-hmm. Oh, excellent. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Oh, that sounds so exciting. All right. Now, in front of you, Diane, you have a gorgeous purse. Tell us about this purse and why it is so important.
This is going to be on our live auction at our Zufari. Mm-hmm. It's a Michael Kors. It will have $100 worth of scratchers and an undisclosed amount of money.
And this is is this an auction item, or how will it work at the event?
It goes on our live auction.
Oh, live auction, so people will be able to bid.
So it's worth about $2,000.
Holy smokes, that's awesome. Have you done that before?
Oh, yeah.
How much does it usually go for?
It goes for a lot.
That's great.
It's very popular. In fact, we do this one every year.
Okay, mm-hmm. Good. Well, let's talk about the event. So it's called Zufari Safari.
Mm-hmm. Zufari Safari, yeah, mm-hmm. We have... Each year we get a different name, you know, different project, but it's our gala black tie fundraiser that we have annually around this time of the year. Mm-hmm. It's like they have a complimentary valet parking.
Okay.
And then the rides will be open.
Oh, really?
And there will also be animal encounters. Our keepers come out with some animals and show various animals around there. And then we have a photo op with our, you know, with our theme in the background. So, yeah, it's a lot of fun. That's a preliminary.
Right.
Now, when the event gets going, we have a catered dinner by Party by Panache. Mm-hmm. We have a set up a dance floor. This is all done outdoors too, in our amphitheater.
Under the stars.
Yeah.
Yes.
Under the stars. And then we have a band. So there'll be dining and dancing under the stars. Mm-hmm. So it's really a
And we have the
event.
Silent auction.
And then our big events are the silent auction and we have the live auction.
Right. And then you have cocktails and a hosted bar. Mm-hmm.
Cocktails hosted bar.
Right. Correct. Excellent. Mm-hmm. And then, like you said, dining and dancing, entertainment.
We also have, every year we have a different drink, signature drink. And and so it's, you know, they concoct something.
Some kind of wild animal name.
They concoct something to fit the theme.
I love it.
Every year. So it's a lot of fun. But then the auctions are the highlight of it.
Yes.
And our live auction, mm-hmm. We have a very, almost.
With about 200 items.
On that side, on
the silent, yeah,
silent,
live, that would be a long time.
Yeah.
But nonetheless, you still have a lot of ways to raise money for mm-hmm. the zoo. I think that's amazing.
Yeah.
And that event is going to be on August 24th, mm-hmm. and that'll be from 5:30 in the evening to 11.
5 to 11.
And mm-hmm. if people are interested in going, what's the best way to get in touch? Is it through the zoo itself, santaanazoo.org?
Yeah, that would probably be the best. Yeah.
That would be the best, because I'm assuming that there's information there about how to get tickets and things like that.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay, perfect. Well, anything else you'd like to tell us about? Something else exciting about the zoo?
Oh, the zoo is always exciting. we, you know, with our ride, for those that haven't been there before, we have a train ride, a carousel ride, mm-hmm. and like I said, we just opened up our 50 monkey Ferris wheel about a year ago.
Right.
But the zoo itself is, it's very easy to get around. You can.
Right.
But between 2 and 3 hours, it's all level walking around the zoo. Mm-hmm. We have various animals. We have a farm area. Mm-hmm. We have a giant anteaters.
That's right.
Yeah, that's always a big attraction.
That's
there.
Right. Mm-hmm. That's right. Well, excellent. Well, thank you mm-hmm. both for being here.
Oh, you're
good
welcome.
Luck on your fundraiser, and it's always a pleasure. Next time, hopefully, you can bring the live monkeys.
Yeah.
Or the live lemurs. Whatever.
Of course.
I don't care. We'll just
course.
Have them come on. Thank you both so much.
Well, thank you.
You're welcome.
Appreciate it.
And remember, if you want more information about the Zoofari Safari, you can go to the santaanazoo.org. We'll be right back.
At the Memorial Care Breast Center, Saddleback, you will always find a friendly face to guide you through your annual mammogram visit. Our staff, dedicated subspecialist breast radiologists, knowledge and innovative technology, awaits your visit to our center. With the Laguna Woods Shuttle Service right at our sidewalk, this convenient location offers you quick access for your appointment. You can expect nothing but the best for all your breast health needs at Memorial Care Breast Center, Saddleback.
And from the Globe, Erica Ritchie is with us today, and she's going to tell us about all kinds of different things from here to there, right?
That's right.
Here from to here to Dana Point.
Here to there, that's right.
Yeah.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning, villagers. And so an interesting thing that we have for this Saturday, if you've got plans and you're looking at things to do, there's a Woodstock Festival that will be held at Clubhouse 2. It starts at 7 a.m., doors open at 7 a.m., and it's going to feature 9 hours of continuous music. So you're going to get enough of music, enough music if that's your thing. You'll also be able to go to a kind of a temporary museum, which is made up from villagers who may have gone to the original mm-hmm. Woodstock in 1969. So you can kind of look at some fun pictures, might see some pictures of some of your friends and neighbors and stuff and be like, oh, you know, that's them. And there's also going to be the photo booth. And this year it's going to have a 4x6 glossy. So last year they had a photo booth, but it wasn't. Yeah. So this time it's going to actually be more of a keepsake.
That's nice. Yeah.
And shuttles.
I've seen those before, like at other locations and stuff.
Yeah, they're
and
fun.
It is.
It's kind of like a nice memento to
put
really up.
It really is.
And,
yeah.
And you might, you know, you might create your own Woodstock moment, right?
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah.
A few years later, but and the shuttles run through the village starting at 11:30 until 9:30.
Okay.
So if you're there a little late, you know, don't fret because you'll be able to get
right.
A bus back. And if music and hippie glory isn't your thing, you can go to the dog park opening, which
right.
is also being held on mm-hmm. Saturday at 11 a.m. And we'll have a photographer there. And we'll get all of the kind of, you know, cute little furry friend pictures and have that'll actually be on the cover of the Globe next week. So definitely bring your dog so you can get him famous for his 15 minutes of fame.
Yes, very good. All right.
And so those are the two events on Saturday. And then kind of a neat feature we have this week in the Globe is a couple here in Laguna Woods Village that decided that they wanted to do something to preserve the monarch butterflies.
Mm-hmm.
And so you remember earlier this spring, there were a lot of butterflies that were flying around and like all around. And everybody was
yeah.
like, what are these butterflies? And a lot of people thought they were monarchs, but they were actually painted ladies on migration to Canada. And so Linda and Tom Whalen, residents here in the village, decided that they wanted to do something to preserve the monarch butterflies, which were not the butterflies
okay.
we saw. Those are a little less prevalent in the area.
Right.
And so they decided that they wanted to start raising the butterflies. And they've been doing it for 3 months now. And in that time period, they have been able to raise 20 fully formed insects. And kind of a funny way
yeah,
to call butterflies
yeah.
insects, but they are, I guess,
yeah.
right? But so we have a neat story about that. And it might be something that villagers are interested in learning about if you want to start your own monarch butterfly raising. You might be able to
all right, that's something
find out,
different.
Find
yeah.
something out from the Whalens about that.
Cool.
Yeah. And so beyond that, we have our letters this week, and we are very happy to report that we had an entire page of letters, which we're always very happy about. And they ranged from discounts on handyman services to now I guess I have to put on my glasses so I can read this, to letters about lost golf clubs, and a letter about keeping Laguna Woods dog poop free. And
okay.
our featured letter this week is from Shirley Weinberg, and she writes, I have to give a shout out to the Fantastics Club. We were taken by bus to Segerstrom Theater to see a magnificent performance of Phantom of the Opera. We had a great evening and a great, great seats, and everyone remarked what a pleasure it was to be there and the ease of the trip. Kudos to Loretta and Jerry for their work, and I'm looking forward to another venue with them. So that's our letter for this
good.
Week, and those are most of the interesting points in the Globe.
Yeah, very good. And you wanted to mention, too, about Dana Point.
Oh,
yes the
thank
whales.
You. Thank you for that reminder. Yes, so this week, it's officially been trademarked. So Dana Point, which is home to Captain Dave's Dolphin and Whale Safari mm-hmm. and Dana Wharf Sport Fishing and Whale Watching, two whale watch charter companies who've basically been rivals for more than mm-hmm. 20 years, have joined together, and they've decided, you know, Dana Point offers the optimum opportunity for whale watching
mm-hmm.
and dolphin watching. So we've got the stampedes, and everybody knows, you know, lately in the news we've had the stories about the dolphin stampedes that were seen here off the coast,
right.
and has gone viral everywhere. So we've got the dolphin stampedes, we have five different types of dolphin, we have five different types of whales, at least, that are seen
wow.
regularly. We also see whales year-round, so there isn't just like only a mm-hmm. single, you know, 1 or 2 months
yeah.
to see it. We've got the gray whale migration that goes by Dana Point, and the Festival of Whales is held each year in Dana Point. It's the longest-running festival. So the two women, Giselle Anderson from Captain Dave's and Donna Kaliz from Dana Wharf,
mm-hmm.
decided they were going to put aside their rivalry and brand Dana Point as the official dolphin and whale watching capital of the world. So that was made official
so
this week.
So they're still separate companies though, right?
Yes. They're two separate companies, but they got together and they created a website which basically kind of explains why Dana Point is the dolphin and whale watch capital
Very
of the world.
Very good.
And people can go on that website, danawhalewharfwatching.com, and get tickets to go on charters and learn more about this.
Okay.
But it's kind of a neat thing, so nobody in the world can now claim that they are the dolphin and whale watch capital of the world. Only Dana Point has that. And the Donna and Giselle plan to take this to the city council. They plan to take it to the county. They plan to take it to the state. And eventually they hope to have a federal holiday declared as a dolphin and whale watching day. So this is a big endeavor for two women who were once at odds.
The federal holiday might be a little hard, but.
Well, I don't know. You never know, right?
Yeah.
If you don't ask, you don't get.
Yeah.
So, yeah. So.
All right.
So
very
that's
good.
That's a neat opportunity.
Yeah, it is, and a lot of fun. And, you know, we've been talking about their specials, senior specials down there.
Yeah.
Now, this one we have on the screen is just for danawhalewharf.com.
Yes.
I don't know if the other company is going to do the same. They probably would.
I think they do,
I would
actually.
Imagine.
Yeah, they do. I think they all run various different specials, and they also run specials for veterans.
Okay.
So it's definitely a fun thing to go. I've been out on the boat multiple times and have been really lucky to see some amazing sights. So.
All right. Very good. Thank you for stopping by, and we'll see you next week.
All right.
All
thank
right.
you.
We'll be right back.
Did you know that the Laguna Hills Lodge was originally built as a place for relatives or friends to stay when they were visiting? In 1968, Laguna Woods' residents built the first two buildings of the lodge because they wanted a place close by for visitors to stay. Since then, the lodge has become the spare bedroom for the Laguna Woods' residents. The lodge has received the TripAdvisor Award of Excellence 8 years in a row. We invite you to stay in one of our recently remodeled garden rooms and take advantage of a special offer for Laguna Woods' residents, family, and friends.
And with me right now is our good friend Leslie Gabola of Adapt to It. And coming up next month, they're going to be celebrating 17 years. Am I right?
17 years, yes, already.
Wow.
Yeah, it's
That's
great.
Incredible.
I'm amazed.
You're going to be having a great event. And today you brought along someone who's going to be there, right?
I'm stuttering. I don't usually do that. I did. We are incorporating an alternative health fair. Mm-hmm. In our celebration, so it's going to be the usual fun food, wine, music, but in addition, we're going to have several people there that offer alternatives to traditional medicine.
Great.
And I brought Dr. Termas on with me today, and I love to bring people on the show with me who I feel are making a really significant difference.
Yeah.
And I have to tell a story. And
first of all, welcome.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for being here.
Yeah, thanks for inviting
much.
Me. Yeah.
Sure.
Thank you.
And so actually what happened was we had a patient and he was in a wheelchair and he was wheelchair bound. And so he decided to do hyperbaric oxygen therapy, which I'll let you discuss and describe. And so he needed to get in the chamber because it's a small chamber, it's round, mm-hmm. and then there's a little seat that you have to transfer onto to slide into the unit. And so he was wheelchair bound and couldn't stand up, turn around, and sit down in the chair, so he had to use a Hoyer lift, a lift.
Mm-hmm.
And this was a rather large gentleman. And anyway, so we transferred him in, and then he did his treatments. Well, a few weeks later, I was asked to come pick up the lift because he was transferring on his own. And he was able to get up, turn around, sit down. And the really cool thing about it is a couple things. This person had had a stroke, and so they had weakness, and had been sitting in the chair for 7 years. And so they were able to go from that status to walking within a couple, 40 hours of treatment.
Yeah, about a month's worth of treatment.
A month's worth of treatment.
So we should mention your company is LifeSource Wellness Care, and it's about regenerative medicine, am I right?
Correct.
And I want you to kind of go into that a little bit, what that is, what that entails, and I think one of the things, because I, before we came in, I was talking with you about it, some of the truths and myths we hear about these type of different things.
Sure. So regenerative medicine basically focuses on the body's innate ability to heal and try mm-hmm. to stimulate those healing mechanisms. So there's a variety of different approaches we use for the hyperbaric oxygen therapy mm-hmm. is one of those. Another is using stem cell therapy and PRP and things like that. You hear about that a lot in the news. But what right. all those treatments are geared towards to stimulate the body towards healing, to encourage it, because it's obviously been blocked for whatever reason, disease, process, injury, et cetera. But what we're trying to do is stimulate and bring back function for the patient, trying to help reestablish their quality of life again. A lot of mm-hmm. these folks, for example, the fellow that you were talking about had been in a wheelchair and hadn't been out of that wheelchair for like 7 years, other than to just go back into bed and
right.
be taken care of by his wife. So his quality of life is improving tremendously, and that's what we're geared towards, is helping reestablish quality of life for these people, helping give them pieces of their life back that they haven't had for a while. So using regenerative techniques, we're able to help stimulate and heal up joints that are degenerated. We're able to help stroke patients bounce back and get some neurologic mm-hmm. function with some aggressive physical therapy. We're geared towards helping restore them back to their lives that they've lost as a result of their disease or illness or injury.
And how do you figure out what treatment is going to work, if it will work? I mean, everyone's different. At what severity these people are at, how do you go about that?
So everybody comes in for a consultation. We review all their medical records and their diagnosis and to find out what caused their problem in the first place to figure out if they're a candidate for treatment, because not everybody is necessarily a candidate for treatment along the way. You have
right.
to, it's different patient selection makes a difference in how what kind of outcome you're going to
sure.
have. And so there's a lot of established data that's out there with research for stroke patients, for example, using the hyperbaric chamber. There's scads of literature, despite what traditional medicine has to say. I've got a whole textbook that just focuses just on regenerative aspects of using hyperbaric therapy and cerebral palsy and stroke and mm-hmm. traumatic brain injury, et cetera. So there's a lot of data out there. The public's just not aware of it. Traditional medicine doesn't really promote it. It doesn't make anybody a lot of money along the way. And so therefore, that's the rub. So what we're doing is we're trying to offer something that patients can't get elsewhere, can't go into a hospital and get. And we use those treatments based on the research that's been, come out to this point in time in order to help establish what protocol we're going to use with a patient. So we may use a combination of hyperbaric therapy and stem cell therapy for a patient
okay.
along the way. And this fellow that we were talking about earlier, that was his goal when he had come in, as we had talked about doing some stem cell therapy after the hyperbaric therapy, except that he just did so well with the hyperbaric therapy. So I told him, let's table this whole idea of the stem cell therapy for another 2 months. Let's have you do aggressive physical therapy. And if we don't need to do that as a treatment, that's all the better for you.
So when someone goes through one of your treatments, I'm sure it's very different time frames for each. What is the prognosis in months from now, a year from now, whatever it might be?
So a lot, we try to get the patients really involved in their treatment because they have to be really dedicated to doing their own physical therapy, like this fellow we were talking mm-hmm. about. I made him quit smoking for 3 months before he could come back, before we could do anything along
right.
the way. So the patient has to be committed to following through and doing what they need to, and then
okay.
then we have things set up with physical therapy, and we do our treatments that we use, be it the hyperbaric therapy or sometimes it's a matter of tuning somebody up from the inside. Nutritionally, they may be unsound, and so tissues are not going to heal very well if they're deficient as far as nutrition, protein, et cetera. Mm-hmm. And so we try to shore them up so they have the best opportunity to heal and just basically give them the best opportunity to move forward and make progress. Time-wise, it's very different from patient to patient.
Okay.
Healing continues with hyperbaric therapy, we know that healing can continue for 3 to 4 months beyond their last hyperbaric treatment along the way. And the great thing is those treatment results are permanent. Okay, so they are not going to go away once the patient stops the hyperbaric therapy, because we're generating new blood vessels to grow up in the tissue there. But healing can continue for a long period of time, provided we give the body the opportunity to do so.
Right. And as far as somebody finding out about you, because this may not, you were mentioning again when we were out front there, that's most of these, as far as I know, aren't covered by Medicare or other insurances. So how do they go about finding out about this? I mean, obviously, if they come to Leslie's event, sure, they will, but just in general.
A lot of patients are pretty savvy as far as the internet, and so they've done a lot of digging. And so their hyperbaric therapy and use with chronic neurologic disease is not a scarcity. I mean, there's plenty of literature out there,
right,
and patients will do their own digging and get their own information, and then they'll try to find somebody who can be a provider to provide what they need. And so the internet's a really helpful thing for them to find us versus coming to Leslie.
But I imagine you got to be careful too. There's probably, you know, do your real research and due diligence and finding the right people that know what they're doing.
Absolutely right. Yeah. I mean, there's a big difference. Hyperbaric therapy, there are these soft-sided chambers which only generate 1.3 atmospheres of pressure, and there's a lot of places, and patients can buy those things and use those things in their home themselves. But really, to get really aggressive as far as treatment goes, you really need a hard shell chamber, in other words, a solid steel chamber like what I have in my office. Mm-hmm. You need to be able to generate at least 1.5 atmospheres of pressure. Between 1.5 atmospheres and 2.25 atmospheres of pressure is generally what we use as far as pressure settings go.
All right. Well, I want to remind folks that they can certainly find out more about this at the Adapt to It 17th anniversary, which will be happening August 15th, right, at Adapt to It from 3 p.m. to 8 p.m. I heard you mention wine.
Of course.
Okay. Where is
you
it?
You know me.
Last year she brought in wine.
But
it's going to be a lot of fun, and we're glad that you've been around her for that long.
Well, it's a blessing to be here. I love this, the Laguna Woods folks. So.
Yes. All
Thank
right.
You.
Well, very good. Normally she brings in little gadgets for us. That'll be maybe next time.
I brought a person.
You brought a person as a gadget.
I've got a big gadget in my office.
You do.
It's just, it weighs 2,000 pounds, so it was a little bit much to bring here today.
All right, next time. All right. Good to meet you, doctor.
Thank
Good
you very much.
Good to see you as always.
Good
Take
to
care.
See
we'll
you.
Be
Thank
back.
You.
Get out and live your life with the Buzz Around XL travel scooter from Golden. The Buzz Around is fun to drive with a tight indoor turning radius, so you can go just about anywhere. It's also so easy to charge and offers all-day range, so you can go further. The Buzz Around even has more leg and foot room for all-day driving comfort. Be safe with the XL's ultra-bright LED headlight. Plus, the Buzz Around XL can be easily taken apart into several lightweight pieces. See for yourself just how easy and affordable mobility freedom can be.
Dr. Farman Cosmetic and Implant Dentistry is located right outside Gate 6 and has been keeping the village smiling for many years.
I trust Dr. Farman with all my dental procedures and all my dental work. Thank goodness I found Dr. Farman.
We have been serving the community of Laguna Woods for almost 20 years now. Come and visit us at Brilliant Smile for all your dental needs.
We are close to Gate 6 near Snooty Fox Restaurant behind Coco's.
Love that ring. Where'd you get it?
I got it at the jewelry box. I saw it on Facebook and then I went in and bought it. They have the most unique, awesome pre-owned pieces for amazing prices.
The Jewelry Box of Lake Forest, voted best jewelry store in Orange County for 8 straight years, offering unmatched prices on fine jewelry and watches, refurbished to new condition.
Visit us in our store or shop our website for just arrived items.
The Jewelry Box, it's about trust.
Memorial Care Saddleback Medical Center, we are a MAGNET-designated facility, which means that we're in the top 8% of hospitals across the nation that are recognized for high-quality patient outcomes and nursing excellence. And what that means is that we have nurses that are highly engaged and enthusiastic about their workplace, that we have lower vacancy rates, lower turnover, and high nursing satisfaction scores.
And our movie coming up on a Friday is a real thriller. It's an adventure drama called Arctic, and it's about a man and I think it's his wife who are stranded in the Arctic after a plane crash, must decide whether to remain in the relative safety of his makeshift camp or embark on a deadly trek through the unknown. And in here you can see that she's obviously injured or sick, and he's got to go out and kind of get help. So really, I think it's sort of an intense movie. As far as the way that they film this, you can see is, you know, make you feel like you're kind of there. So good movie, and it won a lot of awards in the indie festivals. It came out in January, so this will be coming to you on Friday at 2 and at 7 o'clock. And then on Monday, we have a very different kind of movie.
Totally different. Opposite ends of the spectrum.
Yeah.
We have Shazam.
Shazam.
Anyway, that is going to be on Monday, July 29th at 2 and 6 p.m. And of course, we all have a superhero inside us. It just takes a bit of magic to bring it out. In Billy Batson's case, by shouting out one word,
Shazam,
this streetwise 14-year-old foster kid can turn into the grown-up superhero Shazam. And you know, the other movie and this movie, I don't know anybody in it. Not that I know everybody, but Zachary Levi, do you know who that is?
No, I don't.
And Mark Strong, and no. I probably should know who that is. And Asher Angel, I should know who that is as well. But nonetheless, it looks like a very fun movie, action, adventure, and comedy. And that will be
that looks really good.
On Monday. Yeah. Well, you said that was a DC one.
Yeah.
Okay.
The DC universe.
Cool. Yep.
Yes.
Excellent. All right, Monday, 2 and 6.
All right. Well, we're just about out of time. As I said earlier at the weather, we got another humid Hawaii or Florida type day, depending. And you know, you're looking out there right now and you can see there is some rain in the area. You can see kind of the streaks coming down there. This isn't going to be a lot, but do expect some rain if you're watching us in the morning, some light drizzle and to partly cloudy skies. Tomorrow, things should be better, less humid. I think we'll get some morning clouds there, and then going forward, mostly sunny and warm. Next week, though, expecting more humidity to come in.
Oh, really? Okay. And heat. Boy, it's going to be warm.
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
So tomorrow, we have Maggie Blackwell, who'll be here with the United Mutual Update. Dan Oweiler with Sterling Financial, the El Toro Water District. And then we have HOI, which is Hoag Orthopedic Institute. We're going to be bringing you Joe Donahue from Pro Sport Therapy. They have a collaboration that we're going to talk about. So have a great day in the village, and we'll see you tomorrow.
Bye-bye.